Hey everyone, I'm Matt, campus pastor here at Liberty Church Blue Angel. Thanks for joining us today. I hope you and your family are healthy and safe. In today's service, we will worship with our campus worship leaders and hear a message from one of our pastors. If you're new to Liberty Church, I'm so glad that you tuned in. We're honored to have you as our guest. We would love to stay in touch, so please go to libertychurch.net/hello and fill out the Connect card. So many of you give faithfully and generously, and we want to say thank you. Your continued support enables us to continue spreading the good news of Jesus and to meet the needs of those in our community during this time. There are two main ways to give financially in this season. You can go to libertychurch.net/give, or you can mail your checks to our central office. We pray God continues to bless you and your family. And if you have kids, we have an online experience designed just for them. So go to libertychurch.net/updates and you'll find resources for both preschool and elementary age kids. Now it's time for our service to start, so let's join with the worship team.
Praise righteousness of God.
Going to get back into worship in just a moment, but before we do, let's take some time today to pause and reflect just on what Christ has done for all of us. If you have communion elements, you can get those ready, but if you don't have them, it's okay. We can all think about what Christ has done for us. It's critical, especially in the season we're in, to determine what is going to capture our thoughts. The same Jesus who came, who died for you, who conquered death for you, is going to take care of you in this season. So important to remember that our relationship with God hinges on what Jesus has done, not on what we've done. And we drift so easily from that reality. If you've trusted Jesus with your life, if you've repented to God for your sin, you are forgiven. And if you haven't, you can do it now. Every failing and every sin in our life was made up for by Christ's death on the cross. New life is ours because He lives. Our confidence is not in our skill or our intellect, but in our faith in Jesus. 1 Corinthians 11:23 through 25, Paul writes, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night He was betrayed, took bread, and when He had given thanks, He broke it and said, 'This is My body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of Me.'" Let's take the bread. In the same way, after supper, He took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in My blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of Me." Let's take the cup and worship along together.
So great a mercy, what heart could fathom? sing it again.
Hey, Liberty Church family, I'm Kristen, and I want you to know that we are praying for you, and we know that God is faithful and He is good. We are committed to serving you and encouraging you and providing opportunities for you to remain connected to God and to each other. For the time being, we will continue gathering online for our weekend services. I encourage you to invite your friends and family to join you online. Having a community of friends is valuable in times like this. That's why groups are so important. We are utilizing technology to continue meeting online and growing together. So use the link shown here if you want to get into any of our groups. Before we hear today's message, I want to provide an opportunity for all of us to honor God with our finances. We have the choice to honor Him and be obedient to His word. In the Bible, God says to test Him by bringing the tithes to His house. That means we honor Him with the first 10% of our income. Let's do our part and watch God do His part to faithfully provide. There are two main ways for you to give financially. You can go to libertychurch.net/give, or you can mail your check to our central office. We pray God continues to bless you and your family. If at any time you want prayer, you can go to libertychurch.net/hello and select the best option that serves you best. I hope you're ready to hear today's message, so grab your Bible and notepad as we hear from AJ, our campus pastor of our Liberty Church Gulf Breeze campus.
Hey everyone, we are so excited that you've joined us for our service. We've enjoyed worshiping with you. Now, life and home and work and church is not the same, but I believe that there is a great strength that I am seeing in the church as we move in this new season of life. You know, I spent some time this week in just praying and really looking to God as to what He wanted me to share today. But during this time, I saw this image of a building, and this building was actually being emptied. But the people weren't leaving the building. In fact, what was happening is the people, as they exited the building, they were actually beginning to work on the foundation of this building. And I think this is an incredible visual, because I believe God is using this time for the church not to diminish what we do as a church or take away, even though, yes, it feels like Sunday services have been taken away, small groups have been taken away, youth and kids meetings, everything that we see as normal for church has been taken away, but that's not what this is. This is actually a time of strengthening the church and strengthening the church for what is to come, what God is preparing for us to do. Can I get an amen in that? Do we believe it today? I know there's a lot of fear out in the world, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that some today, but I believe we need to be a people of hope. And this is the hope that we have in Him, because I'm going to tell you right now, it is going to be okay. All right, we are going to make it through this. I want you to look at this list that I have. In the year 2000, we survived Y2K. In the year 2001, we survived anthrax. In the year 2002 was the West Nile. 2003 was SARS. 2005 was the bird flu. 2006 was E. coli. 2008, we had bad economy. And I know that was very rough for many of you, but we survived it. 2009 was the swine flu. 2010 was the BP oil spill. 2012, the Mayan calendar said everything was gonna end. The world was gonna be over. 2013, we had threats from North Korea. 2014 was Ebola virus. 2015 was ISIS. 2016 was the Zika virus. And here we are, 2020 with the coronavirus. We lived through it all. And we are going to live through this in Jesus' name. I want to show you that God is a faithful God who is always there for us. Amen? Amen. Well, listen, we want to join together online as we jump back into our series, Nobodies. We started this a few weeks back, and I've loved this series because I love looking at the scripture and finding people in the scripture that maybe we would have passed through. Maybe we would have just skipped on by as we read through the Bible because they were little known, because maybe we see them as just a small part of this. But I want to share with you, and the power of this series is little known does not mean less important. I think it's so incredible to see this. Now, there are somebody today that I want to talk about, and his name is Joseph. This is a little known Joseph. Many of you would know that there are two very famous Josephs in scripture. We have the Joseph of the Old Testament, who was this great savior of the nation of Israel. And then we see that story in Genesis. There's also a New Testament Joseph, who was the earthly father of Jesus, who believed the angel's report and became the guardian of the young Messiah. But then there's a third Joseph in the Bible that we see who often gets overlooked because of the drama of the moment into which he stepped in. The circumstances of when he enters the picture, he gets overlooked. Now, the scene opens up for Joseph to enter in quite a trying time, a time of uncertainty. And immediately, what is happening in this time where Joseph comes in, this is following the death of Jesus. There could be no higher drama than this moment where the Pharisees had falsely charged and murdered the Messiah. This moment where they crucified him like some low-life criminal, and as a part of his torture, they made sure to mock his supposed kingship. Now, seeing this, what happens is the disciples, they fled from this unthinkable horror. But then we have Joseph of Arimathea, and I think it's incredible how all four Gospels actually show us a few things about Joseph of Arimathea. And in fact, Joseph of Arimathea was one of the few men who's actually mentioned in all four Gospels. It shows us, one, that Joseph was a man of great wealth. And although Joseph was a member of the Sanhedrin, which was this supreme religious body of leaders of the land of Israel, made up of 70 elite men, leaders, he was a part of that, but also, he was a believer in Christ. Mark and Luke actually mention this with some subtlety, that Joseph was looking forward to the kingdom. But Matthew puts it even more bluntly, and I want to read in Matthew 27, verses 57, how bluntly he puts this. And it says, as evening approached, there came a rich man from Arimathea named Joseph, who had himself become a disciple of Jesus. But then we see John actually adds in his gospel a little more detail, telling his readers that while Joseph was a disciple, he actually kept this a secret in fear of the Jews. Yet when the time came, when this moment comes, Joseph acts in such a way that makes his faith public. Luke wrote in his gospel that Joseph disagreed with the Sanhedrins on their attempt to do away with Jesus, but that opposition alone would not have fully exposed him as a disciple. He could have still remained hidden in his belief. But then we look at this moment in Matthew 25, verses 58 through 60. And it says this, it says, going to Pilate, he asked for Jesus's body, and Pilate ordered that it be given to him. Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a clean linen cloth, and placed it in his own new tomb that he had cut out of rock. He rolled a big stone in front of the entrance, and the tomb was rolled. It was covered, and he went away. You know, from this verse, we see this moment where there's no doubting where Joseph stood in his belief. There was no doubting where his allegiance was when he boldly went to Pilate to ask for Jesus' body. His request was astonishing. It was astonishing because Joseph stood to lose everything. He stood to lose his influence as a member with the Sanhedrin. He stood to lose his wealth, his reputation, and maybe even his life for boldly asking for this, for taking this step of faith. Yet regardless of the cost, Joseph took Jesus off the cross, wrapped him in spices, and buried him in a freshly cut tomb, a tomb that was his own personal tomb, where in normal customs, because of the criminal death that Jesus died, he should have been buried with the criminals in a dishonorable burial. But Joseph, in this moment, in this act of faith, restores Jesus's honor in this and in his burial. But what do we learn from this example of Joseph? And there's some things in this story of Joseph of Arimathea that I think we take away, especially in as an example, that are useful for us today in the season that we are all in. The first thing I think is important for us to understand and remember is that we cannot follow the crowd. Don't follow the crowd. It's easy to watch the media. It's easy to see the news and to see all of the negative that is being shared and buy into that. But I want to challenge you today to boldly stand firm in your faith in him. Don't let the distractions of what's going on pull you from what God is asking you to do in this moment. Don't let fear and anxiety keep you from being who God has called to be. Just because our circumstances have changed and situations have changed, you still have a call on your life, and we need to be bold in that. The second thing I think is important for us is that we trust in his timing. I'm going to tell you, Joseph had no idea the days or even the weeks before Jesus's crucifixion that he would be the one to honor Jesus's body by burying him according to honorable customs. Yet when the time came, he stepped out in faith. While Jesus's 12 disciples were scattered, Joseph was in the right position at the right place and acted in just the right time. You might be right now in the right place, in the right time, in the right position to act for Christ. It might come today or it might come next week, but I'm going to tell you the point is that we need to be ready. We need to trust in his timing. For Joseph of Arimathea, the opportunity arrived and he stepped out. But I'm going to ask you, what opportunities are awaiting you? What opportunities to step out in faith to do what God is calling you to do? But I think above all of this, in this uncertainty where Joseph could have panicked, where he could have run, he could have scattered like all of the disciples, he knew what had to be done. And I want to encourage you in this moment to have peace, to have peace in this time. Because even this moment of Joseph, even what happens, think about this. We can have peace. Why? Because of who we serve, because of our God. We can have peace because of what he's done for us. Think about this. Even this moment of Joseph stepping in and burying Jesus in his own tomb was recorded in scripture long before all this happened. We see this in Isaiah verse 53, or chapter 53, verse 9. This is what it says. It says, he was assigned a grave with the wicked, right? He should have had a grave with the criminals. He should have been buried dishonorably with the criminals. But it says, and with the rich in his death. When he died, when his body was pulled off the cross, he was actually put into a tomb of the wealthy man, put into a tomb that only the rich should have had. It says, though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth, we can have peace because we trust in him, because we trust in our God. We don't have to fear. We don't need to be worried. We don't need to be anxious. We just need him, the one who gives us hope. You know, maybe that's where you're at. And maybe this is hard for you to do in this time, to have hope. Maybe you're at a place where everything's uncertain. We don't know what tomorrow holds. We don't know what challenges we're gonna face in the hours or the days to come. And having hope is really difficult for you. Maybe you're at a place in your life where your relationship with God isn't where it should be. But I wanna tell you, one, I'm praying for hope in your life. I'm praying for peace in your life because I believe that God is a God of hope and a God of peace and a peace that people just don't understand. A peace that doesn't make sense in this world. A peace that doesn't make sense in this time. Because we know who it is that gives us this peace. But maybe you're at a place in your life where you aren't where you should be in your relationship with God. Maybe you're at a place in your life where you know what you should be doing. You know what you're called to do. But the life you're living, maybe you're just going through the motions. Maybe you're not as committed to God as you know you need to be. Maybe you don't even have a relationship with God at all. But I want to take a moment and I want to talk to you for just a second. There are so many of us that are watching online right now who are at different places in our life. Maybe we're at different places in our life than we even thought we would be today. Maybe if we were like in Joseph's shoes, we would have never imagined the place we would be right now. But it doesn't matter where you are because I want you to know being here in this moment, being here in this time is not by mistake. You watching this right now is not a coincidence. You taking this time to live stream with us and to join us online is not a mistake. I believe that with all of my heart that God brought you here for a purpose, that there's so much more he wants to have for you, that God is reaching down in this moment. And I believe that there are so many of you here that with the uncertainty of the world and the uncertainty of everything that's going on, that you're just not sure where you stand with God. But this is your moment because I believe that God is reaching down. And even though we're not together in person, that we're here online, we're here together, that I'm here with you, and in this moment, God is with us. And I believe you that there are those that are feeling that pull, that feeling inside. I'm gonna tell you that's God. That's God reaching down right where you're at, showing his love to you, desiring to have a relationship with you. This is your moment. This is a refresh. You know, this is a lot like pulling the cartridge out of a Nintendo, pulling the cartridge out of the old Nintendo, blowing all the dust and the dirt, all the things that are keeping us from being who we're supposed to be, pulling it out, pushing it back in, hitting the reset button, starting over. Brand new day. It's all new. To be who we were created to be. And if that's you today, in just a moment, I want to take some time and I want to pray a prayer with you. And if you would say this prayer with me, if you would just believe this prayer in your heart, I truly believe that God will come and he'll begin to change you from the inside out, that this new relationship will form with him, a new life with him. Before we go to that prayer. I just want to pray for hope and peace over each and every one of you. And as we're here, I'm going to offer up that opportunity to say that prayer at the end of this prayer, to make a decision to follow him. But first, let me just pray over each and every one of you right now. Father God, Lord, I pray for peace. I pray for hope. Father, that we would trust you in this timing. Father, that we would trust that you have set up things in our life that are supposed to happen, that we would have faith, that we would not follow the crowd, that we would step out and make a decision for you, that we would do what you've called us to do, that we would be who you've called us to be, even in this time, even in this season, that we would have faith and trust in you, and that you are a God of hope and peace, Father. We thank you for that goodness. And if you're here with us online and you want to pray that prayer, if you want to accept Jesus in your heart, whether this is a renewed commitment or if this is the first time you've prayed this prayer, together as a church, we are all praying this. You are not alone. You are not on your own. There are people here praying this together with you right now in this moment. You're walking into a family. But if this is you, let's just pray this together. Believe it in your heart. Heavenly Father, I want to know you, to be in relationship with you. I understand that my sin has separated me from you. So forgive my sins. Make me brand new so I could serve you and know you. Thank you, God, for new life. I give my life to you in Jesus' name. And everybody together said with them, amen, amen. We love you. We're praying for you. Have an incredible day. Our service host is going to give you instructions. If you made that decision today, we want to connect with you. This is an amazing moment. Let's celebrate with them as a church. Come on, church. Let's celebrate right there in your homes for those that made that decision today. Amen.
I'm Pastor Nate, campus pastor here at Liberty Church North. Thanks again for joining us today. If you just made a decision to follow Jesus or to renew your relationship with him, we're so proud of you and we want to celebrate with you. So would you do me a favor? Give us the opportunity to walk with you on this journey of faith. This starts by you letting us know of the decision you made by going to libertychurch.net/hello. Select click here to connect and complete the form so we can stay in touch. We're here for you. Remember, you can stay engaged with us throughout the week on social media. You can give financially anytime at libertychurch.net/give. And you can ask for prayer at libertychurch.net/hello. We look forward to connecting with you again soon. We love you. Have a wonderful week.